Okay, thank you for allowing me to present this work that we have been doing in the recent years. Basically, I'm going to be presenting the development that we have been doing in creating a package to do a band structural analysis and Fermi surface analysis, which is called PiProcar. I already presented this work in the previous meeting, but I think we have done some new advances that I'm gonna share with you guys. And also I wanna present a second package that we have created, which is called Mechalastic, which allows to do elastic analysis of the result that you get from the elastic constants that you get from any electronic structure code. Therefore, let me just move. Okay, PiProcar then is a package that has been interfaced with different electronic structure codes. Right now it's been interfaced with Abinib, Lobster, Quantum Espresso, ELK, VAS, and DFTB Plus. Therefore, we're allowed to read the output of each one of those codes and read the numerical data and being able to plot the band structures in a single Python command. Therefore, you see here a very simple example where we say that we are reading a PROCAR file, which is the output from a VAS, and we are going to be plotting just the band structure. We can also plot the Fermi surface, and I'm going to be discussing a little bit more on this because we have done a lot of new implementations in this sector. We can also plot the spin structure, and I'm going to be discussing also this in detail. Let me start with a very simple examples that we can do with the PiProcar. First of all, we can plot by using different projections. Therefore, we can say, for example, we can only consider the orbitals related to the T2G. In this case, it's an Lantano Banaday. And therefore, we can plot the band structure only coming from the T2G orbitals. I can also plot only the spin-related like, or I can, for example, superimpose different band structures from two different electronic structural codes. Therefore, I can compare the result from ELK and Abinib, for example. I can also plot different spin channels. I can plot the spin up and spin down. And every one of them will have different tenses. I can superimpose them, or I can plot them independently. I can also select, for example, the atoms. I can select the species. I can select the spin channel when you have a non-collinear calculation. We can select also the line type that we are going to be using. For example, in this case, we are going to use solid for one type and that dash for a different type. That will be nice to compare different band structures. One thing that we also have implemented is that any one of these results is going to be stored in a matplotlib object that allows the user to change any of the features that they want, because something that we have faced is that not all users want to have the same color, or they don't want to have a grid, or they don't want to have the same size of the fonts or anything like that. Therefore, you can change anything based on the fact that you can have access to this. We can also change the method that we plot. We can use like in the old times, we can use a scatter plot, and we can change the size of the symbol by adding the intensity of the contribution of whatever you are trying to plot, like for example the different orbitals or the spin type. Though I prefer the colors, but in any case, I think it's useful for users. In the case of non-collinear spin calculations, we can decide if we want to just use a specific spin projection. Therefore, for example, in this case, here I'm plotting the contribution of the SX, the spin along the X-axis, or I can do it along the Y-axis or along the Z-axis. I can plot all of them together, or I can just plot each one of them independently. This is very nice when you are studying, for example, topological materials, where you want to see if there is any spin contribution. Recently, also, we had the analysis of the density of states. We have many different ways of plotting the density of states. We can use the plane mode, like in most codes you have access to. Therefore, you have, for example, in this case, you have a spin up and a spin down. You can also have the stack mode, in which you can just put different colors for the different orbitals. Types, we can select the type of orbital, or we can also select the species if you want to. Or we can use, for example, we can change the intensity of the contribution by by plotting that within the same density of states and plot them on side by side with the band structure. That's something that some of the users found very useful. We also have a band unfolding analysis. This was something that Ruche did. We generalized it because now besides did, we can not only obtain the band unfolding, but also we can see the band unfolding and the atomic and species and the atomic orbital and the species contributions to the band unfolding. That means that when you have this specific case in which you have, for example, this is the primitive cell, and then you also have the supercell, and then you just unfold the band structure, you can see what are the different contributions of the different atoms. This is an example that I'm going to show in the next slide, which is here. For example, over here, I have the calculation of the primitive unit cell. I have the calculation over the convention, and I can just do the unfolding to compare the two of them. And I can also use the supercell to compare with everything else. Additionally to that, for example, over here in this particular case, I think it's aluminum arsenide. I'm just comparing the contribution of the arsenica before I see the colors are only added by, to that case. I'm sorry, that was too fast. Therefore, in this particular case, I have a lot of options that I can use, and that's something new that is happening in PiProcar. Additionally to that, we also have the two-dimensional spin texture that you can plot. You can have two different methods to plot it. One is you can do it by colors. Therefore, you can assign colors depending on the spin direction. Over here, you see that, for example, this is, for example, SX along the positive axis, and over here, the blue corresponds along the negative axis. Therefore, you will have it in colors, or you can also add the arrows. Right now, we only consider it a two-dimensional projector. That's why you see that, for example, the arrows in this plot, they change the magnitude because they are changing direction in along the z-axis, for example. Okay, and this is something that we started to do in the previous meeting, but now we have implemented many different features on this. Therefore, this is the three-dimensional Fermi surface analysis. We can plot it directly, very simply, by using this plane mode. And this is most of the codes have access to this. But now we can also do a projection of different properties that you have access to. For example, you can look into the Fermi surface and look into the projection of the different orbitals or the different atomic contributions. We can also use the spin texture and plot it on top of the Fermi surface if you're interested in seeing how the spin is happening along the Fermi surface. We can also plot the Fermi surface according with a property. There is one internal property that we have calculated, which is the Fermi velocity on defective mass, just by calculating the Gaussian curvature of the Fermi surface. But also you can read an output of a different property, which is provided in a file, which have to have the same k-match that you use to calculate the Fermi surface. And based on that, we can use that to color in the Fermi surface. Previously, we were able only to read the PROCAR file output from BAS, but now we can not only read this type of file, but also we can read a BXS file format, before like the one that you get from Abinit that you can just obtain by obtaining PRT Fermi. Therefore, we can read that output and use that to plot the result that I'm showing here. This is also something very new. We have implemented giving possibilities to the user to play around with the Fermi surface, because we want to give the experience to the user to have the feeling of what is happening with the Fermi surface. Therefore, the first thing that we do is that now we can have some slider on top of it, and therefore we can have access. And then we can do is that we can change, by changing the slider, we can change the ISO value that we can use to plot the Fermi surface. That allows the user to really understand what is happening with the Fermi surface. Another property that we recently implemented as well is a slice. Therefore, we can define the position and the direction of the slide, but also we can draw a vector on that. And by just pulling the vector, we can move the slide and change the direction of the slice. And the user can play around and they can just look into what happened with the cut of the Fermi surface with respect to the plane that you have defined. Additionally, we can extend the Fermi surface. Therefore, we can replicate the Fermi surface in any direction that you want. This is very useful because sometimes one of the things that we have noticed is that if you want to get a very good Fermi surface, sometimes it's better that you do it with a very large k-match. Most of the codes, due to the graphical interface, you have to calculate it in the unit cell. But now, due to this implementation, you can do it in the primitive cell, and then based on the symmetry that you have in your crystal, you can build the full unit cell by doing this extended direction. Therefore, basically, at the end, you just calculate the Fermi surface on the primitive cell, and then you can get the full distribution of the Fermi surface, even in a supercell-like type of picture. And the last implementation that we have done, which is a suggestion by Matthew Perstrati, is that not only we can have the card in the two dimensions, like the one that we have over here, but also we have calculated the area of the closed trajectories of the Fermi that we have in the plane. This is related to the Fan-Alphen experiment that is used to measure the Fermi surface. And now we are trying to just dig into the corresponding constant that we need to put in front in order to reproduce those measurements. But this is a quantity that now we can be that can be obtained, and it's very easy to be obtained because now the only thing that you have to say is to select to plot the Fermi surface and allow us to calculate the area and use the dragging feature and move the vector in which you are going to be calculating the area. That's with respect to this. With respect to the interface with Abinet, we have two different ways of using that. One is by creating a procar file like the one that you produce in BASC. This is by just using the flag PRT procar equal to one in Abinet. As Abinet runs in parallel, what the Abinet will do is that we'll create several files that contain the pieces of the procar file. And then PyProcar will be able to gather all the different files and create a single procar file that will be used for the plotting. This is a very simple example of that. And if you want to don't use that process, you can always print the PRT XSF, which is also in Abinet for many, many years. And you can read the output of that file to use exactly the same analysis that I have told you guys. Okay, the second package that I want to present to you guys is called Mechalastic. It's a recent development that we have done. It's right now only interfaced with Abinet, BAS, and Quantum Espresso. And recently, I think only like 2 weeks ago, we finished an implementation with a package that we also have created for doing dynamical mean field theory, which is called dynamical mean field theory with DFT. This is a package that has been interfaced with BAS and Siesta. And therefore you can do DMFT on top of these two codes. And this will allow you to do the elastic constant analysis based on DMFT. Therefore, what we do is that we just parse the output from these three different codes, and then we can do elastic analysis. And of course, the main, first of all, we can do it to three-dimensional crystals, and we can do it also to two-dimensional crystals. We can also do equation of states analysis. And additionally to that, we can do the three-dimensional analysis of the elastic constant that sometimes, especially for the experimentalists, is very useful. Therefore, we can see, for example, the ratio compression along in a two-dimensional plot, or we can even see it in three-dimensional. In the case of the equation of states, we can have, for example, a whole energy versus volume calculation for many different phases. And then we can use a network type of plotting to see how the different phases are related with respect to each other. In the case of the mechalastic three-dimensional analysis, this is the line command that you can use. You can do it through a command line interface in your Linux device, or you can just enter into Python and use it as a package. This is the case of the Python call. And you just pass the output of the specific run that you have done. And based on that, it will be able not only to extract the elastic constant, but it will calculate the eigenvalues. That's the one that is telling you how stable is going to be the system. And it will, for a specific crystal stability, will based on the board elastic criteria, it will tell you if the system is really satisfying every one of the conditions that people know for years. Also, it does a lot of analysis that people have been doing in the case of elastic constants. Of course, the basic one that we know is the ball modulus, the shear modulus, and all these properties. But additionally to that, we have implemented some others that some of them come from a specific equation that you can get from elastic theory, and some others come from observation that experimentalists have developed. Like, for example, you can at least get a prediction of the melting temperature based on some criteria that people have put together. Or you can get, for example, the hardness. People have put together many, many different equations to get the hardness. We have implemented at least six different versions of the hardness calculation. And one thing that we found is that the application of every one of these equations is somewhat correlated to the crystal symmetry and the band gap of the system. Therefore, we not only we calculate them, but we also we advise the user what will be the best of the of this equation for to use in the analysis that they are planning to do. We also obtain, of course, the elastic wave velocities and the divide temperature estimated by the elastic constant. In the case of the two-dimensional, we also do exactly the same thing. We do the elastic tensor. We calculate the eigenvalues. We also do the mechanical stability analysis. And then we also calculate the corresponding elastic properties based on the elastic constants, like the modulus, the two-dimensional layer modulus and things like that. And additionally to that, we have an interface to create the analysis of the equation of a state. We have a six different equation of states implemented. Basically, the way that we do is that we can create many different files, which you have the different results of energy versus volume. We can read all of them, and we can plot the enthalpy as a function of pressure. We can also do an estimation of the best of the equation of a state that fills all the data. And based on that equation of a state, we can do the phase transition path estimated by the equation of state that you have been used to do the fitting. And this phase transition path is plotted in a network such that user will find it easier to understand how the different phases are going to be related with respect to each other. And last, we have this two-dimensional and three-dimensional visualization of the elastic properties. For those that have been doing this type of analysis, there is a web interface which is called Elate. And that allows you to do that. But over here is a Python interface that based on the data that you have, it will be plotted on the screen. And therefore, you can play around and you can move it around with your mouse and see how the elastic constants move and things like that. And of course, you can have the two-dimensional projections of these guys and also perform other analysis that you're interested in. Therefore, these are the two packages that we have developed. We have a lot of plans to continue the development of these two packages. We want to improve the Fermi surface topology. We want to do some specific implementations to study the topology of the Fermi surface. We also want to finish the analysis of the cross section that I discussed and how to relate that with the Haas-Fanfel effect. We are starting to do an implementation of the geotropic magnetic effect, which is related to the curvature of the Fermi surface. And we are planning also to move all this learning process that we have done in the Fermi to do similar analysis for the wave functions and the density analysis. And of course, if you are interested to any good implementation and any property that you will be interested, it's very easy. I'm very easy to bribe. You can use a beer and that's it. Thank you so much.